Welcome back, everyone, to another Tony Stewart Sprint Car Racing Setup. Today's video will focus on the 410s at Farm Mill Raceway. Now, this track reminds me a lot of Chicago on the asphalt side of things, whereas it's a D-shaped in general, but the back straightaway is not entirely straight, so you find yourself turning for a lot of the lap, and it allows you to create a lot of speed and maintain quite a bit of speed. The high banking here means that you don't have to lift at all around the track. There's a few different ways you can get the car to turn. One is obviously to make the setup looser so that it will simply rotate on its own. Another way is to drag the brake just a bit on corner entry and use the brake percentage to modulate how much the car rotates. And then, of course, a third way is simply to breathe the throttle, lift off the throttle just a small amount, maybe back off to 90-95% throttle briefly on corner entry to let the car rotate and get it pointed in the right direction. So this track can be a lot of fun. It races very tight. A couple, maybe even three grooves are available here, but when you're racing against the AI, it races very tight and very narrow. So with that in mind, let's head to the garage. We'll begin our setup discussion with the shock values. And here you're seeing we're either using the minimum of 3.0 or very close to that at 4.0 on all of the values. And the reason for that is if you decide to run the extreme low side down very close to the inside retaining wall, then there's some banking transition to deal with where the track gets a lot flatter as opposed to the much higher banking as you get out closer to the outside wall. And I find that these lower numbers help the car to remain stable, even though I'm going over some of those banking transitions. But as always, if you prefer quicker transitions out of the car, then use higher numbers here, up around 6, 7, or even higher, and that should work out also perfectly fine. Moving on now to the weight settings, maximum left side weight and minimum front weight. Really no reason that I know of to decrease the amount of left side weight. But with the front weight, if you find that the car is simply unstable, it wants to rotate too much or rotate erratically, then try bumping this front weight up to something around 39.0 or even higher and see if that doesn't help you to tighten and stabilize the car overall. Then moving to the cross weight, maximum 55%. Now, I think overall, this setup would be considered the tightest setup that I have uploaded thus far. And there's a good reason for that. This track has so much banking that combine that with the way the car drives overall and certain aspects like stagger, then I don't really need any help in the car turning. The car rotates just fine all on its own. So what I'm really focused on is controlling that rotation and specifically controlling the speed of that rotation. And that's where the cross weight really helps me out. The higher the number you use on cross weight, the slower the transition, the slower the rotation that the car will want to have. And that's exactly what I'm looking for. I prefer to steer the car mostly by breathing the throttle, just that we talked about in the introduction. Maybe, you know, 5 to 10% is all you need. And it doesn't take much to get these things to rotate. So I prefer to do things like that, or maybe just touching the brake a little bit on corner entry to allow the car to rotate, and then use a lot of these other settings to tighten the car and then control that rotation. Front and rear heights, really not a big deal regardless of what you use here. I run a little bit higher on the front, helps me out just a bit to tighten up the corner exit, but not a huge deal either way. So you can play around with those. The main thing you'd want to use here is if you find the car is bottoming out, you'd want to make sure that you raise these heights. Moving on now to the torsion bars, and I am once again using either minimum or very close to the minimums on all of these. And then the second thing that I prefer is to use the difference between the left and the right side, either whether we're talking front or rear, to adjust how the car handles. The bigger the difference, the bigger the split between the left and the right-hand side, specifically in the rear of the car, I find to be vital for me. Here, you notice that we've only got one click, only one slot of difference between the left rear and the right rear. That really helps to tighten up and sure up the rear of the car for me, particularly from the center of the corner on to exit. If you want the car to be looser, then you'd want to come in and increase the diameter of the right rear. And that will not only help because the right rear diameter will be higher, but it will also create more of a split between the left rear and the right rear. So those are some things, very easy and quick changes that you can make to loosen or tighten the car. One thing I do not like in these cars is to run the left rear and the right rear the same. That introduces some weird characteristics in the handling of the car that do not suit me, but by all means, try that out and see exactly how that feels for you and see if that's something that you prefer. You also notice that in the left front and right rear, I am not using any of the stops. No preload there, but on the right front and the left rear, I definitely am. And the reason for that is those serve to tighten up the car at different spots on the track. The right front preload, increasing that, and this, I believe 3.0 is actually the max you can use, and that helps me to tighten up the car on corner entry. So the higher the number I use here, the tighter the car is on corner entry. Obviously, lowering this down closer to zero will loosen the car on corner entry for me. Moving on to the left rear, the higher the number I use for the preload here, it helps to tighten the car up on corner exit. The last thing I want to do is get through the entry and the center of the corner well, only to lose it by having the right rear sling out too far and scrub off speed on corner exit. So I use the left rear preload to adjust for that here. Again, 3.0, because this track has tons of banking and tons of grip overall. So really, I'm just trying to control the amount of rotation in the car. But again, lowering this number will allow the car to be looser on corner exit and then through the center as well. Tire pressure, spent very little time here. You notice that the right rear is equal to the left rear, but I find that this is, in general, a very minor change to the feel of the car for me. So anything from maybe 4 up to about 9 or 10 really is hard for me to notice much of a difference. In this game in particular, I notice much more of a difference from the way I drive the car than making some of these setup adjustments. So again, very minor adjustments in the tire pressures. So play around with that and see what feel you end up preferring. Moving on now, finally, to the miscellaneous settings. Maximum left rear and right rear spacing. So 14.5 versus 19 inches on the right rear. Play around with these. The left rear, lowering this number down toward, I believe the minimum is about 13.5 on this. The lower you make the left rear spacing, the looser the car will be. The higher you make the right rear spacing, again, we're at the maximum right now, but the higher the number you use here in the right rear, the looser the car will be. So if you're looking to tighten up the car, then you'd want to either increase the left rear or decrease the right rear. And of course, the opposite also holds true if you want to loosen. Then we come to the brake bias, one of the three ways that I mentioned a couple of times now in the video on how to get the car to rotate. 50% works really well for me at this track. If I drop this down to around 45% or lower, the car wants to get a little bit too loose when I do use the brakes. And of course, keep in mind during the race, you'll probably have to use the brakes some because you'll be in a lot of traffic. So 50% works well there. If I get much above 50% to 55% or higher, then I find that the car just gets too tight and doesn't want to rotate well enough under braking. Then we move on to the wings, 26 in the front, 30 in the rear. So that split of 4 degrees here really helps to tighten the car up. The higher the number you use on the front wing, the looser the car will be overall. And then in the rear wing, the higher the number you use, the tighter the car will be overall. And then along with that, the rear wing positioning, the more negative you make this number, -4, -5, -6, and so on, the tighter the car will be. And again, this is probably the highest negative number I've used at any track to this point. And it just goes to show you how easy the car rotates and the high amount that I need to control that rotation. So if you want to loosen up the car, then your options here in this section would be to increase the front wing and then decrease the negative number here in the rear wing positioning. Both of those will definitely loosen up the car and allow it to rotate much quicker. Wheel lock is at my standard 10 degrees just simply because it works well for me. You want slower movement and response out of the wheel, lower this number to 9, 8, 7, and so on. If you want quicker transitions out of the wheel, quicker response time out of the wheel, then increase this to 12, 13, 14, and so on. Again, I believe the default is somewhere around 17 or 18, so much quicker response time than the 10 that I prefer to use. Moving on now to the steering offset, which is very closely tied to the amount of stagger. For me, 1.75, which is, again, about the highest number that I prefer to use, and that is simply to offset some of the very hard pull in the car from using the maximum 20 inches of stagger. Now, I used maximum stagger here simply because I wanted to maintain as much speed through the corner, but you can certainly build a setup around a lower stagger number, something around 17, 16, or so on. In general, the higher the number you use for stagger, the looser the car will be and the more it will want to rotate and turn all on its own. And then if you want to tighten up the car, use a lower number, something around 17, 16, 15, and so on. That is a very quick and easy way to adjust the handling of the car. If I came in and adjusted this down to say 17 or 18, the car would be much tighter than it is now. So in some respects, you sort of build a setup around the amount of stagger that you want to use. And then finally, the rear end ratio, as always, you have plenty of adjustability here. Just depending on how many RPMs you want to use, how close to the rev limiter you want to be, and how often you want to be there. 4.8 worked out well for me, but I also tried numbers that were even lower than this, 4.6, 4.7, somewhere in that range. So again, a lot of adjustability here, but overall, this is probably the tightest setup that I have uploaded to the channel so far. See how you like it. Maybe you need to tighten it up more. Maybe you need to loosen it more, just depending on how you drive the car. But as always, your lap times are going to be heavily determined by your driving style. I find that my lap times, and by the way, my quickest lap is around 11.80, 11.81, somewhere in that vicinity at this track. But I find that it can vary 2, 3, 4 tenths with the identical setup just by changing the line that I drive on the track and the how hard I drive the car into the corner and so on. So a lot of variability there. And so keep that in mind. As you're working with a setup, just understand that the same setup can vary wildly in lap times just based on how you drive the car. So that's going to do it for today. Thank you very much for joining me, and stay tuned for more Tony Stewart Sprint Car Racing.